Okay, so like I said, I've been dreading this night since I picked up a Bible. You guys have questions in the scripture that you've been wrestling with for years? And you just like don't have an answer? Am I the only one? You guys have it all memorized? Apparently, a room full of biblical scholars. There's Robbie Zacharias. There's Chuck Swindoll. What is this? What am I doing up here? Y'all need to come on up. Like, I've been struggling with certain things. We all have questions that just never seem to go away, you know? And we want them to make sense. We want to try to just reason and make sense of this book and this God that is indescribable. How foolish that we think we could, right? But I try. Tonight might be only for me. Like, I don't know, maybe no one else in the room is a geek. But this, honestly, what I'm going to talk to you tonight is like the thing in Scripture that, I'm not kidding, it actually keeps me up at night. It actually keeps me up at night. It drives me crazy. And most of the time when I wouldn't say most of the time, I would say all the time I've tried to preach out of the Bible from a place of conviction, even if I'm wrong. Do you know what I'm saying? I think I'm right. I study and I research and I pray and concordance and all these things, right? And I come to a conclusion and this, boom, right? Not here, right? Tonight more than ever, you need your Bibles open. Tonight more than ever, you need a notebook. Tonight more than ever, and if that's not a notebook, maybe it's your phone. I had a discussion the other day at Dunkin' Donuts with a friend of mine, and I started taking notes on my iPhone while he was talking to me, so I'd recommend that you do the same thing. Very important that you do that tonight, because I don't preach out of a place of conviction tonight. I'm preaching from a place that I'm not thrilled with, but I told you a long time ago that I was going to preach through books of the Bible, and I wouldn't dodge stuff because it seemed hard, like a lot of people do. And I'm not going to do it. But here's the thing. You don't have to agree with me. Isn't that the beauty of a non-denominational church? You don't have to agree with me. I have spent time for years studying this topic, and I'm going to present to you all that I know, and I'm going to give you what I believe is my position, and I believe that it's biblical. But you don't have to agree with me. All of you have a Bible in front of you? If you don't, you've got orange and yellow ones on the seats. And you can go ahead, and when the scripture verses come up on the screen, you can go there and you can read them for yourself. You can highlight that Bible if you want and take it with you. That's our gift. It's fine. You don't need to bring it back. You can keep it. In that video, to open, about the gospel, the study of the book of Romans and all, there's some questions asked, and that's the purpose of this study, and that is to find out what this gospel is. What is this good news? So that you can be comfortable in it, know that you've been saved, feel comfortable sharing it with someone, because if you don't know the topic, you won't share it. If someone said to me, I've got a group of 500 people and I need you to teach them how to tear down a 350 Chevy big block and rebuild it, Moses, you're up. I would shake in my shoes. I know you wouldn't, Joey.
You take that car apart, I'll take you apart.
But there's some probably in this room that could probably do that pretty confidently. I know that Joey, he builds asphalt plants, right? Those big monsters that you see on the side of the road. He builds that. Got a bunch of people, they have a blueprint, they got the welders, and they do all that. Like, he knows how to do that. It's nothing to him, right? Piece of cake. For me, no clue. And so here's the church in America says, all right, guys, go evangelize the world. How can I if I really am not confident about what I'm sharing? I don't even really know how I got saved or what it means or nothing. So here's the thing, we want to answer these questions about who gets saved, who can even get saved. Is it predetermined who gets saved? Are some without hope while others are without option? And what I mean by that are some people just absolutely predestined, they'll never get saved no matter what, and some people are without option, that if God said, Jimmy, go to these people and tell them about me, that if he refuses, he'll make a way somehow, some way. It's beyond you. That there's no option. They will get saved because I said so. Do we have a part in this thing? Are we just little pawns in the hands of the master? I don't really know. Remember a couple weeks ago we talked about the Holy Spirit, probably been a month or so ago, and I told you I was not a continuationist, the person who says that the gifts of the Spirit, all of them, including tongues, healing, and prophecy, go on even to this day, and I'm not a cessationist, the guys who say that all the gifts of the Spirit live on except healing, prophecy, and tongues. See, I'm not either one of those. I'm just a Christian. And so that's all I'm going to do is I'm just going to read this book and I'm going to draw my conclusions from it because I'm not God. And I'm not going to set myself up in any camp. And I would encourage you not to do that either. Just follow the Lord, not a group and a tribe. And so this topic tonight about who gets saved and how and is it beyond option or hope and is it just God doing, is it predetermined, all that stuff, there's two camps there too. There's two camps. Normally, they're divided. The Christian world are divided into these two camps. There's a camp, they're called the Arminianists, and they've been started by a guy named Jacobus Arminius, and it's a Dutch dude. He lived from 1560 to 1609, and the Arminian position is that you do have a say in your salvation. You do have the ability to make a choice. It's a very, very free will-driven group. Jacobus Arminius was a die-hard, absolute lover of Jesus Christ. He gave his life to the gospel and the advancement of the kingdom, his life for it. And he believed this. That's one group. And there's another guy, John Calvin. Guy absolutely loves Jesus Christ. He was a Dutch dude. He lived from 1509 to 1564. Absolutely, just like his buddy Jacobus, loved Jesus Christ, gave his life to the advancement of the kingdom of God, but he believed that God determined in advance who was going to get saved, and it really wasn't up to you. Today, it's not so much Calvinism as it is called Reformed theology. And so there's these two camps. I'm just going to tell you I'm not either one. I'm just a Christian. We'll start here. We get into the scriptures. You guys know what a car is? Kind of a stupid question, but you know what a car is, right? Is there a picture of a car? You all know that's a nice car right there, right? That's not a nice car? You can grunt. That probably has that big block in there, doesn't it? It's a Chevy, isn't it? Chevelle? That's a bad mamma jamma right there, isn't it? Wipe the drool off your chin, man. It's shining off your beard. So y'all agree. Is there anyone in the room that would not agree that is a car? It is, right? All agree? In favor? Okay. So that's a car. But if I put up a picture of an alternator, would you call it a car? How about a carburetor? How about an axle? How about a rear differential? How about air conditioning? Compressor, how about a radio? Those parts on their own, right? They're not a car. They're important parts that make the car function, right? But they're not the car itself. When you go to a car lot to buy a car, do you ask them who made the alternator and how it's made? Like, is that the most important thing? Or do you just trust that, like, if you're a Nissan guy, if it's a Nissan, then you kind of trust that it's a good product. If you're a Ford guy, you trust that if it's got a Ford name on it, it's a good product. If you're a Dodge guy, if you're a Jeep, whatever your brand is, you just kind of, you go for the car, you don't ask about the components. That's not the most important thing, is it? Are the components the important thing? Do they make up the entirety of a car? One person. Okay. I just to let you know, I really, really, I'm just going to say this in church, I really get off on people responding. I'm just saying, you know, like, I don't get paid a lot, so just like if you throw an amen or a whoo-hoo or a ha-ha, you know, whatever, I like that. Paul, you can lead. Okay. Thank you. All right, cool. Okay, so here's the thing. The reason why I'm saying that is that in Christianity, I think we have I think we're kind of jacked up in our thought process. See, in Christianity, see if you've heard this before. In essentials, unity. In non-essentials, liberty. But in all things, love. Has anyone ever heard that before? A couple people? What that is Christians saying, on the most important things, we have to agree. On the things that aren't quite as important, there's a little leeway, a little liberty there. But on the things that aren't really important, love. Just love. Whatever. You can believe whatever you want. It's all good. Right? And that's the belief system in Christianity. But here's what they talk about. They even fight about that. Christians, that's all we do is fight. We fight about everything. And so when you start talking about in essentials, unity, non-essentials, liberty, they even fight about what are the essentials. And so the normal response after that is, well, what are the essentials? And you'll hear this. Well, is it a salvation issue? Anyone ever hear that one? Is it a salvation issue? Okay, I'm telling you, that's wrong thinking. Is it a salvation issue is not the most important thing. I have here's a bulletin, a news flash. If you don't get saved, God is still God. Do you understand what I'm saying? You're not the most important thing. I'm not the most important thing. So the study of salvation is called soteriology, but to have a proper soteriology, you must first have a proper theology, which is, who's God? That's the most important thing. A proper theology will help us understand a proper soteriology. And so just like the car is the most important thing and the alternator is not, so is it with God. The most important thing is, who's God? And then we figure out about salvation. See, when you learn about the person of God and you get to know him and who he is, it's much easier to understand what salvation is. Who gets it? How? What's it mean? What's it for? How long does it last? Or maybe it does. Who gets to go? Who doesn't? We can't study salvation. We need to study who God is. And so we have to step back and examine the overriding truths of who God is and then let the more specific parts like the alternator and the rear diff and the battery and all that, that fits in. That has to coincide and connect with who God is. Do you understand what I'm saying? So we have to work from the big to the little, but a lot of times these camps set up on the little things and they fight over that when the big thing is the most important. You establish the big thing, who God is, you can figure out the salvation, okay? So, this is what I want to do. I want to start in Genesis chapter 1. Please go there. We're going to evaluate this thing. We're going to figure this thing out, okay? Genesis chapter 1. And many of you might be going, well, now we're talking about salvation. What in the world are we going back to creation for? But here in this verse, I think this has massive gospel implications, okay? Because we have to understand who God is and what he's doing. We've got to figure this thing out. So Genesis 1:26, we go way back, okay? And this is what it says. And please put your eyes on God's word. God says this, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. They're hanging out in heaven, right? They're just hanging out there. And it said, and they say, let us, plural, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, let us make man, meaning man and woman, because we know that he's made both of us. Look around you. It's obvious, right? Don't have to prove any theology there. We're all sitting here. Okay, let us make people, in other words, in our image to be like us. And then he goes on to verse 28, and he blesses this thing called human, and he says, it's very good. He says that about all of his creation, but after he finishes that, his crown jewel, he makes man, woman, he says, bless this human race. Man, this is very good. Now let me ask you a question. Is God talking about certain people? All of us in favor of certain people? Raise your hand. Or all of us in favor of all people, raise your hand. Okay, I would just venture to say that he's talking about all people. He blessed the human race and said, it is very good, okay? That's something we need to embrace and hold on to through this whole evening. Now, after he does this, you all know what happens. The serpent comes along, it's Satan, he tempts Eve, she eats the fruit, her stupid husband eats the fruit too, and what happens is sin enters into the world, into the universe, and everything gets jacked up, they trash the whole system, and so sin enters into the DNA, according to Romans chapter 5, remember we learned this, Romans chapter 5 says sin gets into the DNA of every single person from Adam and Eve all the way down to the present King David said it perfectly. I was born a sinner at the moment my mother conceived me. Every single one of us is a sinner and stands guilty before a holy and perfect God. You all know that, right? Okay, so let me ask you a question again. Is this sin problem, is it for certain people? Or is it for all people? It's all people. Okay, just remember that. Now, the Bible, we were in Genesis 1, right? Do me a favor, go all the way down to the end. Revelation chapter 21. So we go from the beginning, when he creates all this, to the very end in Revelation. In 21, almost to the very end of the scriptures, you see that God is with his people, and they are with him. And all the sin and all the yuck and all the bad that we dread and hate is gone forever. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Okay, we're looking forward to that time. So if we have those two bookends in place, we've got creation over here where God has made all of his people and he likes it, and he's down here with his people and he likes it. So what is the whole story, the meta-narrative of the whole Bible? Right here, this whole thing, the story from here to here is what? It's the story of God and how he's going to get from here to here. Would you agree? Amen. Am I just totally wrong? Okay, so we're on track right now at least. Okay, that's good. That's good. So, God begins his redemptive work, and he does it. His first step in redeeming what was broken and wrong, he chooses to do that with Israel. He finds this, look, Romans once said that he has created all things, everything is beautiful, and you look out and you see that there's a God, but not a single person on earth is responding to this perfect God in the right way of worship. That's what it says. We were all worshiping wrong, right? But he chooses Israel, who, guess what, at that time, they were worshiping wrong too. No one, it says, was worshiping right. But he chose that nation, that itty-bitty little weak nation. Why? So he could be seen across the earth. So everyone would say, wow, this little nation that can hardly do anything, now they can conquer and they can be victorious and prosperous. How does this happen? Oh, they have this God that's amazing and powerful. He can perform miracles through them, right? And so the world could see this amazing God. And they can also look and see a people who are living differently than everyone else was living, because the world was filled with barbaric freaks, and all of a sudden there's a moral code, the Ten Commandments, they're living differently, and the world can see that. So ultimately, everything that is done through Israel is what? To let him be seen and known throughout the earth. And so this story that begins, the biggest display of that is the story of Moses and Pharaoh. It's the story of Moses and Pharaoh. Now again, you might say, well, now how, we're talking about salvation here. How does this have any gospel implications? It has massive gospel implications, so much so that Paul, who wrote the book of Romans, he chooses this story to share the gospel. He is teaching us in Romans 8, 9, 10, and 11, this exact stuff. Who gets the gospel? Who gets saved? Who doesn't? Why? All that stuff. And right here in the middle of Romans chapter 9, he refers back to this story of Moses and the Pharaoh back, that's way, way back in Exodus, and you can read that. But he references this story in Romans 9, 15 through 18. It's a big, long section here, but let me just read you a couple of verses that are kind of summary verses that kind of sum up the whole section. Romans chapter 9, verse 15 says this, "For God said to Moses, I will show mercy to anyone I choose, and I will show compassion to anyone I choose. So it is God who decides to show mercy. We can neither choose it nor work for it. For the scriptures say that God told Pharaoh, I have appointed you for the very purpose of displaying my power in you and to spread my fame throughout the earth." So you see, God chooses to show mercy to some, and he chooses to harden the hearts of others so they refuse to listen. And so this whole battle of salvation and who gets saved, the Arminian thing and the Calvinist thing and the Reformed theology, this is the forefront of the battle right here. And people read this and they see two totally different things. This is a massive, massive issue in Christianity. And listen, I don't want to disturb you and I don't want to make you have no faith, but what I want you to do is I want you to really dig in. And I want you to research this thing. Why? If you're saved, you're saved. That's awesome. If you're not, we can work on that. But here's the thing. I want you to know God. I just want you to know God well. That's all I want. So this is why I encourage you to dig into this thing. Now, this story here that he's talking about refers back to the story in Exodus. It's when the 10 plagues come along. You all know the story, right? Moses and Aaron, God says, hey, go tell the Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, the most powerful man on the earth, the guy who's got all of our people in slavery, go tell him, let my people go so they can go worship me. So he goes up to this most powerful person on the earth, you know, the guy who says, kill him, and they die, right? I mean, this is the most powerful person on earth. And so Moses and Aaron go up to him and say, let my people go. Of course, what does the Pharaoh do? No, I'm not going to do that. He's like, no, I think you really need to do that, because if you don't do that, like, seriously, I'm going to make the Nile River blood. Go for it, dude. So what do? They make it blood. And still, he says no. See, he's a tough guy. Can someone shut that door back there before we lose a kid? That'd be awesome. So he's a tough guy. And so he says, no, I'm not doing that. And so Moses goes back the next day, hey, yeah, you need to let my people go, because if you don't, I'm going to make like gnats and flies and frogs and locusts and hailstorms, and I'm going to this God that I serve is going to destroy your nation. And the Pharaoh's like, no. Do you know who you're talking to here, Moses? I'm the Pharaoh. Like, this isn't going to happen. I'm the most powerful thing on earth. And they treated him like a god. You all know this, right? Egyptian history. They treated him like he was a god. And really, for all intents and purposes, he was, because if he wants you to live, you live. If he wants you to die, guess what? You die, right? He is God of those people, right? And he's confronted with this other God. He's like, heck no, right? So they keep doing these plagues. They keep saying, no, 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 no. Now, if you read in the story, most of the time, this is where it gets a little confusing. You got to dig in and learn. Most of the time, it says, when Moses brought this plague from God to the people, it says that the Pharaoh hardened his heart and said no. Okay, I got that. He's stubborn. He said no. But there's 10 plagues, and I think it's only two of them. Two of them say that God hardened Pharaoh's heart and he refused. You see why I haven't wanted to preach this for 10, 12 years? It's confusing, right? It doesn't make any sense. No, so here's the thing. So God made the Pharaoh heart hard, so he had to say no? Wait a minute, here's the question. So you're telling me, this is just something to contemplate because I want you to know God, right? Does God have the ability to make someone not believe in him? Or the flip side to that is, does God have the ability to make you love him, to make you trust him, to make you believe in him? Because it says that God hardened his heart so that he wouldn't listen, like on purpose. Wayne, you know, for the last 2 years you've been coming to this church and I've been telling you to obey God, but from now on you are not to obey God. Now, you're not to obey God because here's the thing. I want to crush your life so that everyone else will obey him. These are things that, listen, I'm not taking a position, because when you read this, it's kind of like, I don't know, right? I want you to know God. I want you to know God. Not to agree with me, I want you to know God, okay? So that's the question. Now, that's a big question. And here's conjecture. This is just, like I told you, I wasn't going to tell you what to believe. I'm going to just tell you what I believe. Here's conjecture on my behalf. I'm reading this, I've been reading it for years. Do me a favor and look over in Romans chapter 9, verse 33. He's talking about this. Now, God says something here. God said, I'm placing a stone in Jerusalem. That's the cornerstone. That's Jesus. I'm placing a stone in Jerusalem that makes people stumble, a rock that makes them fall. But anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. Here's my take, guys. I believe that God did not say, Pete, you will not believe in me. I believe, not only from the story of Pharaoh, but the story of the Jewish leaders when Jesus came, and the story that I see all the time right here and in the mirror and in our community, is when people who are sitting on their own throne are faced with the God who says, get off of your throne, you're on my throne, give up your ways, take up my ways, make me the most important thing instead of you, and go serve other people instead of serving yourself. Pharaoh goes, no, I'm God, get out of my face. It's the sinful heart that pushes away the God that says, I want your throne. I deserve your throne. And we as rebels, we've been doing it since the garden. No, God, I'm in control. See, place Jesus in front of these religious leaders, right? They didn't want to give up control, did they? They didn't want Jesus usurping their religious control over the people. And so they said no. They were told he was coming almost 800 years ago. They've been teaching out of Isaiah all those week after week after week in the temple. They knew he was coming. And when he came to them usurping their authority, they said no. Only this far. Get away. And Pharaoh did the same thing. Pharaoh was the God of those people. He was the most powerful man on earth. And here comes another God confronting his authority and his power. And he said, no, get away. But eventually, God won. And eventually, God's going to win. He's going to win. The reason why I believe this is not only in the story of Pharaoh, the story of the Jewish leaders, the story of us, the story of me in the mirror, but I know in the Bible, it says this, and listen, I'm talking about God making you either believe in him or not. And some will make you believe that that's the case, that's what he does. If that's the case, why in the scriptures does it say that we have the ability to quench, stifle, or resist the Holy Spirit of God? If he can make you do something, why does he tell us that we can say no to him? I don't understand that contradiction. It bothers me. I don't know. I think you're probably understanding where I stand at this point, but let me just give you a little disclaimer. I'm not Jesus. And I'm human. And I'm trying to comprehend the incomprehensible God who spoke and planets came out of his mouth. And I'm trying to make it all make sense in my little pea brain. And that's what we're all trying to do, right? So I don't really even know. Maybe he can. Who's God in the room? I don't know. Maybe when he told the nation of Israel, go into the promised land that's not yours and kill the Hittites and kill the Jebusites and kill all those people dead and take over their land, maybe he can. And if he can, you got a problem with that? I don't. You know what we try to do? We try to put our human characteristics on a superhuman God. See, it doesn't seem kind of fair, right? It doesn't seem kind of fair that he would go and say, hey, Joshua, I want you to round up your generals, and see all these people out there? That's their land? I want you to go murder every single one of them. So I got into an argument the other day. Not an argument, it wasn't heated, but a heated discussion. Guy in Dunkin' Donuts when I was there. I was meeting with this pastor, but this other dude came over, he heard our conversation. I mean, it was so obvious, he was just there to try to disprove our faith. He came over disguising it with some, you know, how do you receive faith? Dude, how do you want to receive my fist? You know what I mean? Like, that's all you're doing is trying to disprove the Bible. You know, he started out with this phony facade, this veneer of genuine concern, and at the end of it, he's just like, you're foolish, how can you believe that? That's not the God I want to serve. There was no King David, there was no Solomon, there's no historical data for that. Dude, seriously, just please get your crawler and go in the car. Just go away. You know what I'm saying? That's all he was doing. But people say, well, I don't want to serve a God who would do that. You're not God. Like, you know what I'm saying? If he wants to do that, I guess he pretty much can. He's God. So let's get back to the question. Does God decide who gets saved? Or is it truly up to you? Here's another highly contested verse. Back a chapter, Romans 8:29. And you're not going to find it the way I'm going to read it in the New Living Translation because it's terrible in the New Living Translation. It says, For those God foreknew, he also predestined, and you're going to go, ooh, there's that word. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be like Jesus. And so they do the same thing here. Many people say, well, yeah. So here's the thing. Before anyone gets saved, God already knew which ones were going to get saved. That's what they get out of this. But remember earlier I said about Genesis, how everyone was created and blessed, and it was for everyone. And then later on I was talking about the next verse was everyone gets sin in their DNA. We all agreed it was everyone. Here's a simple question for you. How many people since Adam till the very last baby that's been born here in this world, like the last minute, somewhere in this world some baby was just born, right? Probably. How many of those people did God know about? I mean, is he going, man, I never knew that one in Orlando was coming, man. That's so cool, you know? Awesome. And so he knew, right? So how can you say that it's for those God foreknew, would you say it's for certain people? Or show of hands, all people, right? He knew everybody. I don't understand how this gets divided up along the way. I'm not quite sure. So for those God, he knew everyone in advance of them ever being created, and he predestined. That was his desire, that they would all be like Jesus, right? Or would the Reformed theologists would tell you that it's only for certain people. So you're trying to tell me that God honestly wants some people not to be like Jesus? You can laugh, because it's stupid. It said in the scriptures, let us make people in our image to be like us, right? He already said it. So is God going to contradict and say he doesn't want some people to be like us, he only wants certain people to be like us? I mean, come on. Kind of foolish, right? Doesn't make much sense. Let's read here also, Romans chapter 9, verse 22 and 23. Big, big battleground right here. 22, you ready? In the same way, even though God has the right to show his anger and his power, he is very patient with those on whom his anger falls. And then it explains, Paul explains who God's anger falls on, who were made, or some translations even better, fit for destruction. Verse 23, he does this to make the riches of his glory shine even brighter on those to whom he shows mercy, and then explains who those people are. They're the ones who are prepared in advance for glory. Let's camp there for a second, okay? Now, here again, we're led to believe by some that it's some are in and some are not, okay? But let's just do this. His anger and his power, who is that fit for? Who should his anger fall upon? Can someone say it a little louder? Okay, we learned already that in Romans chapter 3 that no one is righteous, not even one, no one is good, no one is seeking God, and all stand guilty before God, right? It says, I think it's in Colossians, that we're all enemies of God before he saved us, right? So his anger, again, this is not for certain people. His anger is on all of us because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Would you agree? Right? You agree. So when it says it's fit for destruction, that word fit in Greek is katartizo, and it means complete and thorough preparation. That means it didn't start that way. It was prepared that way. It was changed. It went from raw material and then prepared for this. Listen, what happened? We all sin, we all fall short of the glory of God, and so we're all fit for that. We've been made perfect for eternal separation from God. Everyone knows we're all fit for destruction. So again, he's talking about everyone. He's not saying that some people are going to go to hell so that some people can go, whoa, I got in and you didn't. Woo! It's awesome. No, that's not what it says. It says that we know that all people are fit for the wrath of God. Do we all know this? Do you know this? Everyone, right? Okay, now it goes on. It says that some are going to receive mercy who were prepared in advance for glory. Go back to Genesis 1. What did it say? He made man and woman in his image to be like him. He blessed them and said, this is very good. Fit for glory. That's what he wanted for all of us. And then Adam and Eve sinned, and now it's broken. Fit for destruction. Prepared in advance for glory. Sin enters the cosmos. Fit for destruction. Again, is he talking about certain people, or is he talking about all people? He's talking about all people. He's talking about all people. Okay, so it would seem possible that some are in and some are not, but I think that God is still talking about all people. Some people predetermined for hell, and some people predetermined for heaven. Let me ask you just this question that just drives me insane. If he has the ability to make you believe something, to make you take a position on something, right? Because that's what some will tend to teach you. If he can do that, why is it that he would make you not believe him just to coerce others to believe in him? Are we connecting here? Why would he do that? We've already established he has the power to make you take a position. Why would he have to? Is God playing games? He's God. He doesn't have to play games. Why would he make you not believe so that we could look upon it and believe? We have the power to make someone believe something or make them not believe. So why would we do this to try to coerce? Wouldn't we just, you know what I'm saying, right? Doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Now, it would seem possible that this could happen because he's God and I'm not. But again, we have to step back and look at the bigger overarching truths of who God is and what he said about all of us to try to figure out the little pieces. The most famous verse in all of Scripture, other than maybe in the beginning God created, Genesis 1:1, maybe that might be the most popular, but I would venture to say it's probably not. What's the most popular verse in Scripture? John 3:16. So here's what John 3:16 says, and a lot of times we hear it and we see it on, you know, the funny clown guy with his hat on at the football game, and we go, that's funny, but we don't stop and think about it for a moment. Think about this. For God so loved the world. That doesn't mean the planet. That doesn't mean the systems of the world. It means the inhabitants thereof. That means us, with all of our filthy, rotten, wretched selves. All of us. Everyone. Remember again, what is it? Certain people? Did he love certain people? Or did he love all the people? All the people. Okay. For God so loved the world that he gave his son. He sends his son. So whoever of this world would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Do you see the theme here? That's just the silver lining going through all of Scripture is he's talking to all people. Do you understand? Okay? Now, he loves the world so much. Let's just pretend for a moment that it was just on that day that he loved the world so much that he sends Jesus. Let's just pretend, even though we know that's not the case, let's just pretend for a moment that on that day, he looked down on this sphere called Earth. He said, man, I love all those people so much, I'm just going to send Jesus down there to save them. But some of us will be taught that not everyone gets in, that he really predestined some to go to hell and some to go to heaven. But wait a minute, he loved everyone so much that he gave them a way out. Maybe has that changed? Well, let's just read here for a second. Romans 8:38 says, I am convinced that nothing could ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Okay, so what this says here, not only is it amen, awesome, great, but just think for a moment. He loves us so much. He created us to be like him, to worship him in his image. He blessed us. He said,
you're blessed. It's very good. I love you all so much. Here's Jesus, and nothing can separate us. My love for you is never, and nothing can break that. Except I'm going to send some of you to hell. Negatory. Not happening, bro. That just doesn't make any sense to me. It doesn't make any sense that he's talking about all people all the time. The human race is beloved and blessed in his image with value, and he loves you, and nothing can change that. It's been revealed. This amazing act of love of Jesus Christ himself stepping off the throne in heaven to come down and save your sorry hide is the display of God's amazing, miraculous love for you, and nothing can change that ever, anyone, anywhere, anytime. Nothing changes. Nothing changes. And so, you get to the next verse, which is 1 Timothy 2:3, and he says, again, that God wants all people saved and to come to a full knowledge of him. How many people yet does he want saved? Wait a minute. Can you repeat that? I didn't hear you. All people to be saved. Okay. If you're not convinced, do me a favor and go to Acts chapter 17. Just want you to know God, that's all. Acts chapter 17, look at verse 27. You have a question what God's purpose is here, you know, on this earth. What's he doing? What's he doing? What's he doing? Who's going to get saved? Who's not? What's he doing? What's the story, Lord? Tell us. Verse 27, his purpose was for the nations. Is that inclusive or is that just certain people? Because we all agree with who agrees with the Great Commission that we should go preach to the nations, which means every person. Who agrees? Right? Anyone disagree? We shouldn't tell certain people, or do you agree? So you all agree that when the Bible, when God's talking about all the nations, that means every people group everywhere, right? You all agree with that. But it says right here that his purpose was for the nations, everyone, everywhere, to seek after God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him, though he was not far from any one of us. Look at 30. God overlooked people's ignorance about these things in the earlier times, but now he commands everyone, say that,
everyone.
Everywhere,
everywhere,
to repent of their sins and turn to him. Now I tell you, I believe that's a very compelling case, the fact that God wants all people saved, and that he has not predetermined that some will, even though I love you, son, I'm going to make you go to the abyss, lake of fire, forever with his gnashing of teeth and forever torment, because I love you. I just don't see that in Scripture. I don't see that in Scripture. I will say this. When you look at back in the days of the Jews in the Promised Land, and when they killed all the Hittites and the Jebusites and all that kind of stuff, I still have a hard time understanding all that. That's why I had to give you my disclaimer of I'm not 100%, you know what I mean? Because that's still kind of, it just doesn't sit. You know what I mean? I mean, it doesn't. But I tell you something, I believe with all my heart, after studying this thing for years and years and years, something happened at Calvary. Something big happened at Calvary. Something really, really big happened at Calvary. In Romans 9:25, it says that those who are not my people, I will call people. Before Calvary, before Jesus went to that cross, who were God's people? Anyone? The Jews. One nation out of all of them, right? So who were not his people? Who else? Everybody. Who said that? You get a cookie. Everybody else. So there's the Jews, and then there's everyone else. Would you dare say that's the nations? Kind of makes sense, right? And what does he say here? Those who were not my people, that's everybody else, I will now call my people. I ask you again, is that certain or all? Okay. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. You make up your own mind, okay? You don't have to agree with me. You can start your own church. It's fine. Listen, it's for all people. Now, will all people respond well to that call? Because he says, I'm going to call them. Hey, everybody, come to me. I love you. I've made provision for you to be with me forever. Will they all come?
No.
Have they ever?
No.
I understand that. They won't all come. And some would argue with me that when I say something changed at Calvary, they'd say, oh, you're a heretic because God never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Moses, you're wrong. And nothing changed. And you know what? I agree. Nothing did really change about God. Something happened about our perspective on what he was doing. See, almost 800 years earlier in the book of Isaiah, God says, this guy, Jesus, is coming, and it was always my good plan to crush him so that you might live. Nothing changed. Our perspective changed, and God's next step toward Revelation 21 is now unveiled to us. That's all that's really happened. Nothing's really changed, okay? Now, here's another one for you. Romans 9:15. Go there. Romans 9:15. This is another battleground right here, but it's totally different for me. Maybe I'm a whack job. I don't know. You can do whatever. It says right here, for God said to Moses, he even throws my name in there just to really knock me for a loop, I will show mercy to anyone I choose, and I will show compassion to anyone I choose. And here's what the argument is. Reformed theologians will say that that means that he's choosing to show it to some and not to other. But yet all of Scripture since Genesis 1 is talking about all the people. But yet somehow something's changed and he's not going to be, he doesn't want them, he doesn't love them, he only has certain ones. I don't understand that. This verse is often quoted to prove that God chooses some and not others, but for me, it's taken me to a new level of love for God and for all the people. You know, inspire greater evangelism to all people, because I think it speaks of God's call to all people through Jesus Christ. See, when it says, I will show mercy to anyone I choose, and I will show compassion to anyone I choose, I don't think that means he's picking and choosing. I think he's still speaking to us. The fallen people who don't want to get off of our thrones, and the ones who want to pick and choose who should come into the kingdom, because he's rotten. He doesn't clean his room. He's rotten. He's a drunk. He's a this. She's a that. We don't want them in our church. We don't want them. They don't deserve it. No one deserves it. And God says, listen, I will show compassion on even the ones you think are the most. Jeffrey Dahmer, if I want him in, he's in. Saddam Hussein, if I want him in, he's in. Who are you to pick and choose? I'm God and you're not. So that's what he's saying here. I believe with all my heart that his desire is that all people come to know him, because that's what it says, through Jesus Christ, because that's what it says, and that's what he came to do, and that's our job, to go out there and preach the gospel to the world, even to those who we do not believe deserve it. It says in the scriptures, and you have to do something with these texts, it says, you can't just blow them off, it says that he died, Jesus Christ died to take away the sin of the world, not for some. John the Baptist saw him coming, he says, what? There's the Lamb of God who takes away what? The sin of the world, that means all people, not just some. He says, for whosoever, that means anybody, shall call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. Everyone, everywhere, to turn. He says, I overlooked your ignorance before, but now everyone, everywhere, must turn from their sin and turn to God. Every single person, not just some. If that's the case, how can someone turn to him? How can God command them to turn to him if he's already predestined them and pre-wired them to deliberately say no to him? It makes no sense. God's not playing a game. Even the ones I dislike or the ones that I think don't deserve it. So again, I just want to throw this out there to you. Do you think that God has the ability to turn on the heart to believe? Because if he does, why is he playing a game with some of us and making us not believe so he can coerce others into belief? Why would he do that if he can just make them believe it, right? That makes a whole lot of sense. I just can't imagine that. Getting ready to land for the night. And I got to tell you that I think you guys all know my position right now. I think I've made it quite clear. But I want to tell you something. All this debate, all the stuff that keeps me up, it's all stupid. It's all stupid. It's totally stupid. You want to know why? You guys want to know why it's totally stupid, honestly? Let me give you an example why it's totally stupid. Watch this. Do you guys know that the ancient Greek manuscripts didn't have punctuation? Are you aware of that? So every period or comma or whatever you see in here, it wasn't there, right? Okay. Go to Romans chapter 9, verse 18. Let's play the comma game. You ready for the comma game? This is what it says. So you see, God chooses to show mercy to some, and he chooses to harden the hearts of others so they refuse to listen. Now that's the Reformed theology playground right there. He chose you not to believe so that you wouldn't listen, like on purpose. Let's play the comma game, because there weren't any. Put a comma between others and so, and it changes the entire meaning of the sentence. And what it means now is, he confronted them with who he was, with the lordship of Jesus. And as a result of that, just like Pharaoh, just like the Jewish leaders, just like you and me who don't want to get off our throne, I refuse you. Changes the whole meaning of the sentence. All of a sudden, the Bible went from Calvinism to Arminian, just like that, over a comma that we don't even know if it ever existed. That's how stupid this debate is. It's so stupid that the guy who wrote it, God said, Paul, write half the New Testament. Write Romans 8, 9, 10, and 11, right? It explains the whole thing. And Paul, he writes all this stuff down. He's getting it right. For those of you who have preached, you know, you're sitting there and you're like, and you're writing stuff down, and it's like the Holy Spirit's pouring into you, and you're trying to keep up, right? And there's Paul. He's writing this stuff down, inspired by the Holy Spirit of God. He's writing this stuff down, right? And he gets to the end of chapter 11, and he says this crazy thing about salvation. Y'all know that God wants you to obey him, right? Does anyone know that? Is that news to anyone? God wants you to obey him. Do you all know this? Okay. He says, if you love me, keep my commandments. He made 10 commandments. He said, keep them, right? You know he's always encouraging you from cover to cover to obey him. And in Romans chapter 11, verse 32, after he explains who gets saved, why, how, he says the most mind-blowing thing. For God has imprisoned everyone in disobedience so he could have mercy on everyone. Whoa! You're telling me that after all these, look what preceded this. All that. All the way through, you're telling me, obey me, change your ways. And then Paul says, no, God has imprisoned you. You can't obey even if you wanted to. Why? So I could be awesome and beautiful to people that suck. Woo me! Does that make any sense at all? Anyone here? Does that make sense to anybody? No! And Paul, it doesn't even make sense to him because look at his next words. He busts out into song. Paul's not a singer. He's a hardcore evangelist, and he says, in response to this, the next word out of his mouth, oh, how great are God's riches and wisdom and knowledge, how impossible it is for us to understand his decisions and his ways. How impossible! Himself, I don't even understand what I just wrote. Really, John Calvin? Really, Jacobus? You think you understand? I don't even understand it. It's impossible for us to understand his ways. He goes on to say, he says, for who can know the Lord's thoughts? Who knows enough to give him advice? That's a rhetorical question. Who knows enough to give him advice? You better not raise your hand. And who has given him so much that he needs to pay it back? Like, in other words, like I need to explain it to you. I think nowadays we say as if. A whatever. And you do the head thing, right? Yeah.
Look what he says here. This is so cool. He says, for everything comes from him, exists by his power, and is intended for his glory. All glory to him forever. Amen. Right? He says, listen, it doesn't make any difference how it all went down. Mr. Calvin, Mr. Jacobus Arminius, it doesn't matter how it happened, because the fact that it did, all glory to me. Not all glory to John Calvin. Not all glory to John Wesley. Not all glory to Jacobus Arminius. All glory to God. Okay? And that's it. Listen, I'm not either one. I'm just a Christian, and I want in. And here's the thing. I am. Yay! I'm in. I don't even know how it happened. I don't know how it happened. One day, I totally didn't believe, and now I do. Praise the Lord. I don't get it, right? Does anyone understand how it all works? Because I'd like to know. You please explain to me, because listen, we'll go to the tomb, we'll find Paul, we'll uncover him, and you can teach him, because he didn't even understand it. And he wrote it. He wrote the words that you're deciding your position on, and he didn't even know what he was writing. It's an awesome section of scripture. Let's see if I can find it. Where is this precious? I gotta find this. This is so cool. There's a section. Oh, I love this. This is so beautiful. Romans chapter 12, the last sentence in verse 16. It's so simple, you don't have to read it. Listen, you ready? And don't think you know it all. People think they're going to go into a church and they're going to have some guy in a three-piece suit and stand up and go with that deep voice, thus saith the Lord, I ain't him. The Bible says, don't think you know it all. And Paul, who I will never be, God won't choose me to write another chapter of the Bible. Do you realize that? He will never choose me to do that. The Bible's closed. It's done. Can you imagine all the returns people would have to bring in to all those Bibles that have been bought with that incomplete? It'd be crazy. He's not going to expand it anymore, right? So who am I? Who are any of us to believe that we think we know the answer to these things? It's insane. So here's the thing. If you've been saved, don't try to figure out how it happened. Celebrate. It's awesome, right? Yes, you can clap. Don't half-heart it, clap. Like, it's awesome, right? It's good, but here's the thing. If you haven't been saved, if you're here drawing breath, you should celebrate too, because God made a way for you to be saved. Now, can you decide whether you're going to say yes, or has he decided that you got no shot, or that you do, or maybe he's imprisoned you in disobedience so that you'll say no and then he'll make you get saved anyway. I don't know how it all works, because there's a case for all of it. But you got a chance right now. Like, I think I know everyone here, but there's some people here I don't really know. If you haven't said yes to Jesus, you can right now. Not pressure, no coercion. Maybe God's making you say yes right now. I don't know. But if he is, hallelujah. If he's not, just do it anyway.
Amen.
Right? Why not? What do you get to lose, right? Just say yes. So I don't really understand how it all works about how you get saved, who gets saved, who's able to get saved, and all that kind of good stuff. But I will say this. Meredith and I, like, I love my wife. She loves me, I hope.
Yeah.
I've been down this road. You all better say yes. I don't need this headache. Okay, so listen, you know when you start a relationship with someone, you're not supposed to say I love you first, because then you lose? Right, that's a stupid Seinfeld thing, right? I don't remember who said I love you first. I don't. I really don't know. Did he say it first? You're such a wimp. That's cool. No, just kidding.
Anna Rose.
Woo! Making us look bad, bro. I don't remember who said I love you first. Like, I don't know how all that love started,
But I can tell you about how your love and God's love started. So I don't know, understand the whole salvation thing, really. I just know I'm in, which is awesome. But I can tell you that the Bible tells us in 1 John 4:19 that we love him because he first loved you. So first God loved you, and he shows this great love. The greatest way, the greatest display of his love to you is sending Jesus to pay your price on the cross, to take away the sin of the world. See, if you just focus on that, how the salvation thing happens, like, don't give me an algebraic equation, E equals MC squared, it doesn't matter. The fact is that God loved you even though you were his enemy. See, most people would, some people would maybe do something good for someone who really loved them or was nice. Jesus did something beyond comprehension for people who despise and loathe him. Active, every single one of us, active rebellion against God since the moment of our conception, but he still dies for us anyway. Now, keeping that in mind, right, that theology frames our soteriology. That theology of God's love and who he is for all of his people, that should give us some framework on how salvation works for people. Proper theology said that God is the creator who chose to make humans to be like him. He blessed them, he loves them, and he made a way for you to experience this love through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, the Lord, period, the end.